today I thought that the topic should be the common link between the orthopedic surgeon and physician. So I thought of talking about osteoporosis management. So starting with some little basics, what is osteoporosis? It is just the bone disorder which increases the risk of fracture due to reduced bone marrow density, bone mineral density, and leading to decreased bone strength. So mostly it is an asymptomatic condition until it manifests to us with the low grade fractures. So the basic pathology is of the impairment of the remodeling. So normally there is a balance between the osteoclast and osteoclastic activity, but when there is an imbalance between that and osteoclastic activity exceeds the bone resorption, in that case is osteoporosis is seen. So there are many volumes.
Is there any condition between osteoporosis and a normal bone? See, the point is, without, you know, the young patient with minor trauma, they are getting fractured. That position was not there previously. If you ask any, slip thing or manufacturing thing, body or manufacturing, that was not happening previously.
That is maybe osteopenia, not labeling it osteoporosis basically. This pathology does not come there, but osteopenia is a bone weakness. Main is disuse. The disuse atrophy muscles, the disuse osteopenia bones, which is very common in the sedentary lifestyle. So because of that, whenever they have low grade trauma, sometimes what happens, they feel that the grade of trauma is low because they just flip like that. But exactly,
fortunately, as a physician, I am finding many stress factors without any trauma.
Stress fractures without any trauma is because of overuse. Because of if they go for that is common, and that is not related to osteopenia or osteoporosis. That is because of the overuse syndrome. That is a different entity in our orthopedics. Because of overuse, because the muscle power is not that developed, they have been overdoing without gradual increase in the strength. So in that cases, it is very common. Even march fractures, which is seen in the military personnel, the fracture of the base of the fifth metatarsal, that is overuse fracture, that is a stress fracture basically. The same stress fracture is also seen in shin, in the overuse, in the athletes also. But that is not because of osteoporosis, that is because of the overuse. So there are many hormonal and the growth factors which have important role in the bone formation. The important receptor, the ligand, is the rank L ligand, which we also focus during the management. So these rank receptors are formed from the osteoblast and bind to osteoclast, and leading to accumulation and maturation, and basically maintain this normal cycle of bone formation. So talking the primary basic pathologies or etiologies of the osteoporosis, so we can generally divide it into primary and secondary. Primary, which are seen according to in the age, elderly age group, because of age, gender and hormone deficiency. The secondary may be some comorbid disease like inflammatory diseases, rheumatoid arthritis leading to early osteoporosis, or medication like glucocorticoids, and some other long-term metabolic disorders which also leads to osteoporosis. So the common osteoporotic is
regarding this, you know, when it comes to drugs, you say steroid, rather than steroid, many patients are on anticonvulsants.
That also leads to.
The other thing I wanted to ask you, see, many our patients are in hypothyroid. That they are taking atropine, sometimes overdose, sometimes underdose. Many times overdose because the patient do not monitor, sometimes doctor do not monitor, and what happens? They land in higher dose of atropine. Do it for the osteoporosis.
Yeah, all
because the when it comes to drug exposure, at present frequently prescribed drug is atropine. See, Tom Dick and Eric point 5.5 25 mg atropine abididi. Without realizing whether this person do require, this lady do require, when you see 12.5 milligram, 25 micromole, they are taking for long time and they are not realizing, they do not have hypothyroidism. And this is the, you know, this atroxin, means the thyroxine is over-prescribed. Tom, Dick and Harry, moment, see, nowadays, you know, the system of getting health checkup done, 40 pages of health checkup, and they find that the common, you know, common, poison coupling hand, vitamin B12, vitamin D, TSH, these are the three factors, and they will find that so the vitamin B12 is also common. The point is, injection, everything is prescribed, particularly this atroxin. They find 5.5, 6, 25 micrograms of atroxin is prescribed. And then after 6 months, patient comes, you find that now the TSH is 0.05. This is my point is, is there any study with regards to overdose of this? And it is safe. The thyroxine can cause
osteoporosis. Clinical hypothyroidism subclinical hypothyroidism is also now an existing terminology and it is existing entity also, disease entity, which is defined as harmful, not only from osteoporotic or bone point of view, but it is also harmful to thyroid point of view. Definitely.
But generally 12.5 and 25 micrograms cannot lead to osteoporosis. They are almost placebo.
Yes. It is, see, it is not the, it is a, you see the PSH. Yes. The PSH is 0.05 and use.
But the basic the problem we face, the normal hypothyroid patients which comes are of proximal muscle weakness, which may, like the patient will have seen bone pain, arm pain, calf pain. So this might not be related to osteoporosis but muscle weakness because of the hypothyroid. The important thing about this, the common osteoporotic fracture which we encounter regularly is the hip fracture, including lengthophibular fracture, interorganic fracture. The second most common is after the spine fracture is distal radius fracture, leading to proximal infrastructure. All these are low-grade trauma fractures, just for the fall or sometimes not because of fall also. When the patient has been shifted from one side to another side, they encounter proximal infrastructure. All these are very common osteoporotic fractures. So talking about the screening and diagnosis, so the screening guidelines vary greatly in all the literature that is available, but the general consensus is older than 50 years old of age, you should receive, have BMD screening very regularly, that is every yearly, before the start of treatment and after that to observe the ongoing treatment. And other is fracture risk assessment tool, which is little complicated, but for the Indian population currently the BMD, the EXA scan is really important. So these are the normal T score, is less than minus 1 or higher. Then osteopenia is minus 1 to minus 2.5, osteoporosis is 2.5 or minus 2.5 or lower. So the non-pharmacological treatment of osteoporosis includes vitamin D and calcium.
But you detect by only DEXA.
DEXA.
There is no other method which can detect osteoporosis.
First, the most important is clinical judgment about osteoporosis. That the patient is having any back pain, long-term back pain. If you get an X-ray, you see there is a end plate of the bone on the vertebra. So there is a compression of the end plate. There is no frank fracture without any history of trauma because of the severe osteoporosis. There is bending, there is kyphosis or there is scoliosis, any vertebral changes are there, or there is, in talking about hip, there is a persistent hip pain, there are undisplaced fractures, on the x-rays of this hip, there is a lot of osteopenia is seen, there is something called Singh's index. In that, there are normal trabecular lines are present on the hip. So that there are normally 5 lines are present, so out of them 2 or 3 lines gets disappeared. All these are other way of finding the grade of osteoporosis before fracture. So if you want to get the imaging, spine x-rays and hip x-rays will suffice sometimes.
Before. Most of the time these are osteoporosis is asymptomatic.
Most of the time it will be asymptomatic.
Which symptoms are, you say, the C or he may be having.
That is why it is. There will not be any symptoms. That is why the screening is very important.
If elderly pain person says, can I have bony pain? What does it mean?
Maybe because of osteoporosis, we might get the EXA scan for that patient. We see the levels. Supplementation, I'm not talking about dietary calcium. Supplementation lead to renal stones?
Not not a single factor. When it comes to stone formation, there are multiple factors involved.
There are many
not patients. Only patient tendency to develop stone. That is first thing. And second thing is the water intake. If water intake with patient tendency to develop stone is there, and if you take calcium, obviously that patient is going to get deposited with oxalate, phosphate, or
there are, phosphate. Yeah, that is also one of the things that there are many formulations of calcium, and they say that calcium orotate doesn't cause stones. Calcium phosphate, calcium carbonate causes stones. Calcium orotate is definitely expensive, so they will say it is not causing stones, but there is nothing like that. And this remains a controversy. There are a lot of nephrology papers also, but it is not a clear thing that it causes stones or does not cause stones. It has to be individualized. And asking my cardiologist about the cardiovascular risk associated with increased intake of calcium, there is no.
There has been a recent paper that it increases the cardiovascular risk.
But in that they say that dietary calcium does not increase, it is protective, but supplemental calcium, but it is again controversial. It is like inner stones on the bone. That some papers say that it increases the cardiovascular risk, some papers that it does not matter from the placebo, there is no difference. So these two remains
all, the patient always would say if I have a high calcium score,
we need a cardiologist to answer that. That's, if that is the case, should we continue calcium or not? And the other thing is dietary calcium. So whenever we are advising our patients that you what our patients ask us very regularly, they, what are the diet which contains calcium? The our first thing what we'll say will be milk and milk products. They are rich source of calcium. But the new Harvard studies and Cleveland studies, US people are behind milk because they are all going vegan. So they are saying that milk and milk products in adults do not provide enough amount of calcium. So that is not a good source of calcium for adults. There are a lot of studies which says that this calcium is not helping us. So we have to rely on either supplements or other non-vegetarian food or any other green leafy vegetables which provides, or soya milk and everything like that, which provides more calcium than milk. Talking about vitamin D, then again it is a controversy that if we should take vitamin D daily, like 600 international units, which are available formulations along with the calcium, or weekly, which is 60,000 international units. So what is your take on it? You give daily vitamin D supplementation or you give once a week? That is what is more preferred than, but the dose, and also do you get the vitamin D levels or do you monitor vitamin D levels on the patient which who are under vitamin D?
Collective data says 85% of world population is vitamin D
deficient.
Yeah,
definitely.
But whether you do it or not doing, it doesn't make any difference.
But after the patient is taking vitamin D, patient presents with muscle pain. After 1 year, 2 years, when you have started vitamin D, you know this is a vitamin supplement that I have to take lifetime. You start taking once a week.
The thing is that you give for 2 months and the supplement if it is deficient, give once in a month.
Some patient without any.
Right from first day, you have to talk to them. See, this is our Indian population. Once you say it in Tamari Levy person, they are going to
take it like
very first day. That explanation should be given. There
is something called hypervitaminosis, and that presents with lot of other complications. Talking about the pharmacological treatment, the first line of treatment is always bisphosphonates. And in routine practice, we commonly use alendronate and zoledronic acid. Zoledronic acid is in our routine orthopedic practice, we give it once a year, followed by oral alendronate to be continued, 70 milligram weekly. And the newer treatment.
Here again, the duration of the treatment. It should not be more than 5.
5. Yeah. And the other treatment modalities which are denosumab, parenteral inhibitor, and then hormonal and like teriparatide, which we commonly use. And calcitonin dual, there are nasal sprays available of calcitonin, which is little controversial, as in
guidelines which have been presented in recent, like in last decade. First is the ACE 2016. They talk about postmenopausal osteoporosis, and for that, when there is no history of any fracture, they have bisphosphonate in the first line of treatment or denosumab, and as an alternate, they use ivermectin or raloxifene. And in the patients who have any history of fracture or any other high risk for fracture, like there is severe osteoporosis or bone mineral density, in that they clearly on the first line treatment only they start teriparatide and zoledronic acid.
Zoledronic acid itself cause fracture because of the lines,
the zebra lines we are talking about. That is common, but it is seen in the younger population. As in, it does not cause, as in, there are a lot of studies in the metaphase, it makes metaphases weak. They say on the longer run, but we are giving it once a year, and that we don't even observe this zebra lines. That are seen in the patients of the younger population, pediatric patients who receive zoledronic acid for osteogenesis imperfecta. In such patients, it does increase risk. The other study, talks about bisphosphonate as a first line of treatment. Raloxifene for the younger postmenopausal woman with low BMC or with osteoporosis. Teriparatide for the high risk of fracture. And calcitonin is only considered for the woman who have menopause beyond 5 years. This Endocrine Society talk about the guidelines for men. In that, they consider zoledronic acid for the high-risk patient like recent fracture, non-oral therapy with gastrointestinal problems, and or the patient with the teriparatide, because when there is a spine BMD and LN-200 is more than LN-200. And now when we have a steroid-induced osteoporosis, so it has to be individualized according to fracture risk, dose and duration. So they recommend men and women of more than 40 years of age, or any adult with more than 30 years of age, where their cumulative dose is greater than 5 gram, first line of treatment is bisphosphonates over teriparatide and denosumab.
Is there a duration
they have
given for 5
years?
5 years. For steroid also 5 years.
That is to be started with steroid.
Sorry?
For preventive purpose.
You have to start with steroids or afterwards?
No. Along with the steroids.
And you have to make sure your serum calcium level is not.
No.
Or else you need to give calcium here at least.
Yeah. And this is the American College of Physicians study. In that, for women, LN-200, bisantronate, zoledronic acid for 5 years, and for men with osteoporosis, bisphosphonate is recommended, but no specific agent. So these are some meta-analysis to see the efficacy of the bisphosphonate. This included almost around 700 papers all around the population which is available. And they found out zoledronic acid to be the most effective in preventing fractures. And this other study on the safety and efficacy of the teriparatide, because it has been used a lot of times by orthopedic surgeons. And they said that it reduces 53% of the non-vertebral fractures and around 35-40% of the vertebral fractures. And this is for the postmenopausal gynecological paper has presented the ACOG guidelines, and they recommend teriparatide. And the other guidelines were recommending bisphosphonates, but this gynecological paper is recommending teriparatide for the treatment of postmenopausal osteoporosis up to 2 years, where there is a high risk or there is a significant bone loss.
Why the genome is not highlighted? It is to be given once in 6 months.
But
easy to keep.
But today it will give.
Apne koi guidelines hai ki nahi? Indian guidelines koi?
They are again going the genome. Why it is not highlighted? It is to be given once in a six month.
But
it is very easy to give.
It has been all the guidelines they prefer bisphosphonate as first. After that, it is denosumab. And if there are a lot of high risk, then teriparatide. This is the general the conclusion is this much.
Because even I have to give. This postmanite, I will donate chronic acid once in a year. Because the thing is that this postmanite patient has to be educated. How to take this postmanite?
Because a lot of gastrointestinal.
If it is not taken properly, it is going to cause GI issues or esophageal ulcer. They have to sleep for a half an hour.
For chronic acid, we have to at One is romosozumab, which is monoclonal antibody inhibits sclerostin, which has the highest fracture reduction rate in all the treatment which is available, which is 73% fracture reduction rate. Other was this came and now again went off because of the increased risk of stroke. And again, this is lasofoxifene. Again, that reduces the fracture risk, but it is considered safer than the other option. Because when we talk about all the bisphosphonates and the safety is concerned on giving them for long term. So, to conclude, it is a major cause of morbidity and disability in elderly. Screening of patient is important based on age, gender, and other risk factors. It is preventable with diet, lifestyle, and fall prevention measures. And bisphosphonates and telegraphy are the first line.
What about the prevention?
Taking
care, can share
that all remains, that is what I was saying, that all giving daily calcium for longer time again gives rise to questions of is there any risk of cardiovascular, is there increased risk of renal stones, does it really help when we talk about in preventing, because the literature is very, it is not supporting or it is not even against it, so it is very controversial that only calcium and only vitamin D helps. So there are a lot of issues of calcium absorption also. There is not much absorption if you only take calcium. So for that people say that because these people, especially the postmenopausal women, will be very low on recombinant parathyroid hormone. So first you give the patient for 3 months PTH. After that you give the patient vitamin D, and along 1 month of vitamin D treatment you start the patient with calcium. Then you will see better results. So this is the protocol which has been followed by a lot of orthopedic surgeons, especially after osteoporotic fractures, because now it is a very common thing for all of us to at least start osteoporotic if affordability is not an issue.
I think a weight-bearing exercise is the important thing for prevention. If you do weight-bearing exercise, see, well, Dr. Sukhetu Trivedi has aisa Trivedi. He used to say that banne haath mein 10 kilo wazan rahe na, ek ek pag 10 ghanta ubha. That will strengthen your hip joint. I am near here.
There are BMD machines. They do it from the calcaneum. I go lot of camps. I see, from seeing the person, I will know that his BMD will be normal or not normal. Because if he is fit, if his weight is good, if his physique is good, definitely his bone mineral density is going to become normal. No matter what is his age, around 65 years of age, his BMD will be better than any 30 years of age. Even if it is a female or male. So that weight-bearing exercise, regular physical activity does.
The weight is there by the vehicle set rhythm. The thing is that most of the young people prefer, you know, the weight-bearing is by the vehicle, not by themselves. So obviously they are going to become osteopathic and osteoporotic. And so when it comes to male, what is the important factor for osteoporotic? And what about, see, we don't say andropause most of the time for male, you know. But it do occur, andropause do occur in male. So when it comes to female, it is 48 years, the menopause starts, you know, average. So what about male? And what are the important factors for male osteoporosis?
That is, for male osteoporosis, it is mainly their physical lesion, physical activity. In the sedentary life, people have been observed to have early osteoporosis. Obese people have more osteoporosis. But in males, the muscles are a little stronger than females. So the deformity, bony deformity of the spine is not that common like it is seen in females. But they do play a role, and the hormones also do have a role. There are some papers which talk about testosterone therapy for males in the treatment of osteoporosis.
There is a study that the female risk increases after menopause. When it comes to male, 65, 70, is there any age after that age, when male and female are both the same as far as the risk of fracture is concerned?
Not aware of any of these studies, I have not seen or tried to find out like that. But the guidelines says they give 20 years of leverage to males. So what if they are high risk, if the female is high risk after 50 years for any osteoporotic fracture, for male, that guideline will say 70 years. So that is one difference, because don't know the reason, but these hormonal changes are leading early osteoporosis in females. But again, what you said, I have not seen like that direction, that if any other factors apart from the hormones or metabolic problems which leads to osteoporosis in kids.